getting, the guys at work say 411. I guess that's right. I don't know what 411's information, right? I was getting the 411 on the rattlesnake in the fellowship hall. Now, don't everybody lift your legs in panic. I don't think there's that many people, had that many in here. Maybe none. But there has been, we killed one, a neighbor killed one close to the Gurley Pike, not too far from us, and then Seth killed one up at his house. And then here's another one in our fellowship hall. It's small though, wasn't it? 10 inches. Yeah, Shelby Jean, she is a snake killer. If you need any help, give her a call. Now her techniques, I understand, may not be what you would expect, but it doesn't matter when it comes to a rattlesnake. All right. There are a lot of passages that we could look at to continue our thoughts on prayer. I just want to sort of touch on some instances and some things that address some aspects of prayer that we didn't get to touch on last week. And if we get through that, we'll just go ahead and go into the fill-in-the-blank activities. So open up your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 4. Start class with prayer. Father, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful that it's the Lord's day. The privileges and opportunities we have to come and to worship and praise Thee and honor Thee in our lips and hearts and to give Thee thanks, to praise and honor Your Son, Jesus Christ, who shed His blood that we might have hope of life eternal. We pause and think of this day as we reflect back that on this day back in history, there were those who visited an empty tomb. And we realize the power at work in resurrecting Your Son from the grave. We pray, Father, that we won't trivialize this, or we won't take it for granted, but we'll realize You are a powerful God and You keep Your word. And we pray today as we study and worship that we will give all we can within our abilities to praise and honor Thee. We pray, Father, that You will realize that, and we know that You do, that our shortcomings, and we pray, Father, that You'll help us to recognize those, to repent of those, and to make every effort to overcome those things that cause us difficulty. We pray, Father, this morning for those who are suffering and struggling and are going through things that no one even knows about. And we pray, Father, that You'll bless them and help them to realize the power and the comfort that comes from being in Christ and being within Your stronghold of safety. We pray, Father, that You will bless us. We pray, Father, You bless those who preach the truth today and every day. We pray, Father, that You'll hold up their hands that they might not be weary. And we pray, Father, there might be some way that those who will speak false doctrine, that they might be exposed, and that people might come to awakening of what the truth is in the Scriptures. We pray, Father, that You'll continue to bless this nation, turn us around, help us to realize we need God in our lives, help us to realize we need to hold on to principles that we can find in your word, and that we will head back to those truths and principles that have caused this nation to be great in the past. We pray, Father, that you'll continue to bless those who protect us, those who watch after us in their daily jobs. Protect them from those who have hatred in their hearts, for those who have no conscience about killing. And help us, Father, to be able to survive as we live upon this earth. Help us through this day of worship, through the days ahead. Continue to bless this congregation with all that we have ongoing, all we plan to do. May all it be in for the purpose of bringing honor and glory to your name, growth of the kingdom. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. We talked last week about the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, and we talked about that. A lot of people refer to that as the model prayer. We talked about how that had its purpose at that point. It had the points that need to be addressed in a prayer, but that there were some things about it that weren't appropriate for us to pray, and we tried to point those out. Well, we need to understand that prayer was not all-encompassing. Jesus wasn't trying to pray a prayer that would say from start to finish, this contains everything that you need to ever pray about. For example, we don't see praying for the sick in there. And certainly Jesus was compassionate toward the sick. And yet we don't see that. We don't see him praying, telling them, teaching them how to pray for the sick, and maybe other things that we see that are left out. But we understand that this was just an example. And we need to understand that. It's an example that Jesus gave of how to pray. Now, if you read and study the scriptures, you come to the understanding that there is prayer for things that are needful. Jesus, as he approached the death upon the cross, in John chapter 17, we see Jesus praying intently to the Father. And he's praying about a number of things. You don't see him reciting the Lord's Prayer. So there are people today that we talked about who will cite what we refer to as the Lord's Prayer on a number of occasions. We said sporting events, other activities. People, when they're asked to pray, have been taught that, and it's a repetition because that's all maybe they know. But prayer is something that is based on a needed situation. What do we need to pray for? When Jesus was praying to the Father in John 17, he was praying for his hour that was coming. When he prayed in the garden, he was praying toward what was coming. And trying to, we don't understand it all, but trying to see if the cup could be his cup and explain that. That's a difficulty. You hear lessons about it. Let this cup pass from me. It was something he was going to have to partake of. And he was saying, I'd like to bypass this and not partake of it. All that it entails. And we can come up and we can say, well, maybe it was this and maybe it was this. And we can come to a list of things that seems like he was praying for. And we might not actually be correct in everything that we think. So we don't understand it totally, but we know that prayer is based on need. And that's what we have to understand, those things that are needful in our lives. In James chapter 1, for example, says, if any man lack wisdom, do what? Let him ask of God. And so the idea there is that we ask to God, we communicate with God through prayer. So we pray for wisdom. When Peter was in jail, and they were concerned for his life in the book of Acts, what did the Christians do? Where were they gathered? At one location, and they were praying for Peter. Whatever they could do to pray for his release or pray for his continued good health or that he wouldn't be harmed, they prayed for that in that situation. So when we see prayer talked about, we talk about prayer in terms of those things we have need of. It's a personal thing. It can be something that is, as we pray in public, it can be for those things that collectively we need, but it's praying for those things that are necessary. It's not just something that we go through and do as a mechanical part of our worship, or an implementation of it being, oh, we're supposed to pray, so let's pray. And so we need to be understanding that prayer is based on what our needs are, what we need to pray about, what other people's needs are, praying for them. And so prayer is something that's it's a personal thing. It is something that is part of our worship. It's part of our daily activity. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17, I think it is. Paul instructs the Thessalonians to pray without ceasing. Now, that doesn't mean that we get in our cars and bow our heads and start driving down the road. I mean, we have to understand some things. The idea there in that particular verse is be able to pray at any time. Don't live your lives in such a way that you find yourself in a situation where you cannot bow your head and pray to the Father, because of the life you're living. So pray, be able to pray at any time and any place that we might find ourselves needing to pray. And what a fabulous concept that's there, that we can at any point in our lives when we are finding difficulty or struggling with something, that we can pray to God at that point. And that he's listening to us. In Hebrews chapter 4, we see some confirmation of that. If you look at the idea of God, and we certainly can't cover everything here, but let's look at starting with verse 13. Just to get a concept of who it is we're praying to, and the idea that we have this great high priest. Verse 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. He knows everything. I tell you, sometimes it's interesting this time of year. I'll sit down to eat a meal or be somewhere, not necessarily associated with a meal, but maybe I'm sitting down at the end of the day, I'll turn on the television, and there's this little tiny thing flying around my head. And I can't hardly see it. I'd like to kill it if I could. It's bothering me. But can you imagine that God, there's no creature that's not evident in his sight, that he doesn't know about. And, you know, if you see swarms of the insects, it's like, how many are there? And you can't even number them, yet God knows about every creature. He's aware of all that. That's who we're praying to. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. We can't hide anything from him. Anything that we do, we think, well, nobody knows about this. And we try to teach our kids growing up, God always knows. You may think you're getting away with something, but God knows you've done that. And that concept is biblical, and it's truthful, that God knows what we're doing. Everything is naked and open to his eyes. If we think we're hiding something, God knows about it. And so he says, seeing then that we have a great high priest, which he's already discussed in here, that Jesus is our high priest, and the idea that the high priest were the only ones that could enter into the most holy place to offer the sacrifice for the sins of the people once a year. Well, Jesus entered, they had to repeat that year after year. Jesus entered into the most holy place one time and offered a sacrifice that made him the great high priest, such that sacrifice didn't ever have to be made again. And he says, seeing that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, our confession, the American Standard says. We have professed to be children of God. We have, and he's writing to the Hebrew Christians who were struggling with, you know, the persecutions that they were ongoing, whether or not they wanted to stay faithful to Christianity or go back to Judaism. And so the encouragement here is, look at what you have that is so much better. You have this great high priest who is in heaven, who is in heaven, and yet he says, because of that, because that he's the Son of God and he's in heaven and he's there for us, he says, you need to hold fast to what you've professed, that you're a Christian. You hold fast to that, no matter what the consequences come. For he says, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. And that scripture lets me understand that Jesus, when he was exposed to temptation, was tempted. Some people think that Jesus was, oh, he was the Son of God. He was deity. He couldn't even be tempted with the things of this world or whatever Satan would put before him. But this says that he was tempted in all points, in every manner in which we were, with one exception. And that is that he did not sin. And so that's who we have in heaven for us, who knows us, who knows the temptations, the trials that we undergo. And he says, because we have this person, this entity, this deity in heaven, who's gone through all this, and he's before God who knows all things, he said, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. Now notice he didn't say, let us come arrogantly before the throne of grace. That's an unacceptable attitude. But when we talk about boldness, we talk about confidence. Let us confidently go before the throne of God because of who's there for us. If we're living the lives we're supposed to live and we're being clothed by the blood of Jesus Christ so that we appear righteous before God, and he is our representative there in heaven to speak to God for us, there's no reason we shouldn't approach him in confidence. Now, if we're living in rebellion and we're saying, okay, I'm going to do what I want to do, and I'm over here trying to do these little sins in darkness that nobody knows about, which he's already told us God knows about them, then we don't have that confidence. We don't have that boldness. But if we're holding fast to our profession, our confession, that we are believing Jesus is the Son of God and we're following his teachings to the best of our ability, we have this confidence. And he says, if we come boldly into this throne of grace, he says, we do this so that we may obtain mercy. That is, God will look at us and he will give us the things that we need. And several passages we just didn't have time to look at where it says Jesus conveying to us that if we pray believing, we will receive. And if we pray doing his will, we'll receive. And so we have to understand that God is always willing to give us what we need, have mercy on us. We know we're not perfect. We know we sin. But we have that avenue such that we can say, I'm sorry for what I've done. I repent of those things. And then because of that, the mercy of God is extended to us. And so that we can find grace, that unmerited favor. In our lives, in most cases, you take a situation, maybe at your work. Here's a guy who comes in one morning, starting time's 8 o'clock, he gets there at 9:30. The supervisor says, you're a little late this morning. Yeah, I'm having trouble getting up. Kid was awake all night, whatever. And so I just couldn't get here on time. Well, some things happen. It's understandable. Maybe my car broke down, whatever. I'm here late. You know, there's reasons for that. You can accept that. And you know, you just have to take people sometimes at their word initially, even though they may not be telling you the truth. Well, if that guy keeps showing up habitually, two or three times a week, an hour, 2 hours late, just comes strolling in, doesn't offer to come in and give it a reason why he's late, or it's a lame excuse. Over time, what's going to happen to that employee? They're going to get rid of him, right? Well, you know, it's not that way with God. Now, if we are trying to do some things that we think God doesn't know about and just sort of stay quiet about them and just act like we're, you know, everything's normal and ask God to bless us, that's just not going to be the case. But if we're trying the best that we can and we make mistakes and we pray to God, say, God, you know, we're human, we make mistakes, we're trying, we're struggling, God is going to give us what we need. That's to continue to bless us with the forgiveness of sins. And that's an unmerited or a gift that we don't warrant. It's not a gift that we've earned. There's no way we could get that based on what we do. When people make the argument about trying to work your way to heaven, you need to understand that's not going to happen. There's no way that we did the things that we need to do other than through the faith in God and the blessings that come through Jesus Christ, that we're going to make it to heaven. It wouldn't matter. You start talking about somebody trying to talk about show your faith with your works in James chapter 2, well, that's understandable. If you say you are something, if I were to say I'm a doctor, and you bring patients to me, and they say, well, I can't see them right now, or some other excuse. After a while, you understand, this person's not a doctor. He can't treat anybody, right? And so we come to the conclusion, this person is not a doctor. And so if we're trying to be something that we're not, God's going to know that. But works are something that it wouldn't matter what we did. It wouldn't matter how much we did. If we spent every waking hour of our life to go do something that was positive in men's eyes, we cannot earn salvation. It doesn't matter. So when you start talking about work, well, you're trying to go to heaven with your works. There's no way. It's never possible. It would never be possible. You could never do enough. Well, here's the reason. Let's say I went down and just, you know, was involved in all kinds of community activity. I did walk for the Heart Association. I did walks for cancer, and I raised money. Spent all my waking hours trying to do things. Visited the hospital. Well, guess what? I could say, well, you were at that activity, but you didn't go to that activity. Well, I couldn't be at two places at once. Well, it was available out there, and you didn't do it. It's just ridiculous that we think that we could talk to people and say, well, you're trying to work your way to heaven. The only way we're going to go through heaven is by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Now, once we are His servants, what are we supposed to do? Ephesians chapter 2. We're supposed to go about doing what? Good works. Sure, that's who we are. But it's not because of what we do that's going to earn our way to heaven outside of obedience to the will of God. And so when people start talking about works, well, I can tell you something every day this week that I did that was supported some good thing, like raising money for somebody whose house burned, or you know, trying to stamp out cancer, or, you know, yeah, we can do those things. And there's nothing wrong with doing those things, but the point is we'll never make it to heaven no matter how many works we do. So we ain't gonna understand that. Well, here we have someone who is in heaven waiting for us and allowing us to approach the throne of God. Now, that's just amazing thing to me. There are places that we go to. There are, and you could understand this if you work in top secret facility or something. There's places that you can go, and there's places you're not going to go unless you've got the proper clearance. And then there are probably even places above that that you can't go if you have certain clearance, that because it's just at such a high level. But we, you and me, can approach the throne of God. I can't directly go talk to the president. There are a lot of other people in the world I can't go directly talk to. I'll never get into them. Why do you want to come see them? Well, I just want to have a conversation with them. No, it's not good enough. You have to be, you have to have a certain agenda. It has to be something that they want to talk about. You're just not going to go see them. But you and I can talk to the supreme being of this universe because we have rendered obedience to the gospel and we have come in contact with the blood of his son. And he's in heaven. They're waiting for us to communicate with him. And that's just, I don't know how you can get at an any higher level than that to understand that God is willing and wants to talk to us and is going to give us the things that we ask for if we ask in faith, if we ask appropriately, not amiss, because of our own lust, then God's going to listen to us. Now, that doesn't mean that God's going to always answer our prayers exactly as we want them. Tragedy occurs sometimes. Here's someone who's been in an automobile accident and they are paralyzed. And your prayer is, God, I want you to restore their health. I want them to be completely like they were. And I want you to give them strength and abilities as it was before they had the accident. Paralysis is gone. Well, you know, certainly it's good to pray for anybody to have their health restored. One of the most precious gifts we have is our health. And when it's gone, we suffer through that and we struggle through that. And we see other people struggle through that. And we say, wish they could have their health back. Well, it's great. We certainly want that. We want people to be restored to where they were. Doesn't mean it's always going to happen. There are things that we have to understand. We just do not have the awareness of everything going on. And I don't know how God's mind works, but I do know this, that he knows all things. And he knows the future. And he may have reasons why the answers are not exactly what we want. I mean, you can pray for someone to have their life extended. They've lived their life out. Their body's worn out. And you can say, please, God, let them live on. Well, that may not be what God knows is best for them. And so, although it's very difficult for us to leave somebody or somebody leave us, that may be what's best. And so we don't always just get what we ask for in the terms that we ask for them. That's why we need to pray for things that are achievable, things that, you know, if someone is of age that their body is given up on them, is it appropriate to say, God, extend their life 10 more years, or give them a peaceful time to die? You know, we pray for 10 more years, but God's saying, that's not going to happen. I'm going to give them a peaceful time to die. So we need to understand that when we ask for things, if we're not careful, if our faith is shallow, we'll say, well, God, you didn't give me what I asked for. Well, there may be a reason that we don't understand why he didn't do that. But rest assured, if you're faithful to God, and you are living your life the best that you can, and you pray to God, He is listening, and He will give the best results. And so we have to be aware of that. And sometimes, as we talk about, we pray amiss because we pray out of our own lust. That's our own desires. That's what we want to happen. So we need to pray for those things, and God will take care of it. He'll take care of the situation. I've looked back on things that have happened in my life, and I see where God has headed me in the right direction. He has answered my prayers in an appropriate way. As things would play out, I could see where God had answered the prayers in an appropriate way, but not necessarily the exact way I asked for. And we have to have that kind of faith when we talk to God. He knows all. He sees all. He's a caring, loving God. If we're living faithful to Him, He will take care of us. And that doesn't mean we aren't going to have some bumps in the road, but He will take care of us. He'll give us the things that we need. And so praying to God is something that we need to take full advantage of and not make it mechanical, not make it the same thing that I always pray when I get up in the morning and pray for the, you know, thankful for my bowl of cereal. You know what I'm saying? God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this food. Help me have a good day. Amen. You know, it's that, don't pray without meaning. Don't pray without understanding. Don't pray without thinking. We talked about last week. Prayer is a tool that we have available to us. Don't misuse it. Right? We need to understand that. Okay, let's get started into our fill-in-the-blank activities. And you'll see how far we can get before the bell catches. When a Christian prays, he's actually, what? Talking to Almighty God. It's not a casual conversation between me and someone else. Oh, how's it doing? You know, did you get all that rain yesterday? It's not that kind of conversation. You are talking to Almighty God. Now, the difficulty is for us as humans, like, well, I mean, I didn't hear what He had to say. I didn't say a sentence and then He gave me an answer. You know, that's not the way prayer is. We probably would like for it to be that way. Well, I talked to God yesterday and He said this. Well, that would be something that we probably would like to have happen, but that's not the way it is. So, given the way it is, we need to understand still that we don't hear that feedback verbally from Him, but there's communication taking place, and it is us talking to Almighty God. And I think part of that is because for our faith to come shining through. I know what I've said to God. I've given it to His hands. I know He'll take care of it. And we'll see what happens. But I know that God is watching out for me. That faith comes into play because we are not going to verbally communicate with God. That's just apparent the way God has established it. So we need to understand that. But that doesn't take away from the fact of who we're talking to. And we never take that for granted. Number two, prayer is mentioned 25 times in connection with the life of Christ. Now, do you think that Christ only prayed 25 times in the 3 years He was here? Or so, whatever time He spent, approximately 3 years? No. You know that no doubt He prayed so many times to the Father. You imagine that? You see this group you've chosen, you say, I'm going to destroy the temple. We'll build it back in 3 days. Or some statement like that. And they've got that huh look on their face. Huh? do you understand what I'm saying? Oh, yes, Master, we understand what you're saying. Can you imagine that? I'd have to be talking to God. God, I'm trying to work with these people. They're just not getting it. Can you imagine? Here he is. All the things that he said have come to pass. He's meeting with them before he ascends into heaven in Acts chapter 1. Master, is this when you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? They just don't get it. Jesus would have been praying to his Father a lot. He didn't pray just 25 times, but the Bible does record 25 examples of when Jesus prayed. And so we know he did it. We know he prayed at times when he was in difficulty and some things were coming that he was going to have to face. But he didn't only pray in times of crisis. So we need to understand that prayer is something that we should have a part of our lives on a daily basis. Number three, only Christians can approach God in prayer and call him Father. You might scratch your head about that just a little bit. Sort of maybe, I don't know. But you stop and think about it. Who is the Father going to listen to? Now, we know he answered Cornelius' prayer, right? Cornelius' prayer came before God in Acts chapter 10. His prayers came up before God. He was listening to them. What was Cornelius wanting, though? He was wanting to know the truth so he could obey it. Well, there's no indication that the relationship was there that he was a son of God, that he was a Christian at that point. God listens to people who are pursuing those things that are right, that they want to have happen. Now, he's not going to be addressing them as his children because they have not been obedient to the will of the Father. They are not, they cannot approach him as Father because we are children of God by what? How do we become part of the family of God? What's the process? We do it here on the earth all the time. If someone becomes part of our family that was not born into our family, adoption. We are his children by adoption. That process comes about by us being born again into the family of God. And so we can't address him as Father unless we're Christians. That's a true statement. Because we're not his children until we become obedient to the will of the Father. We've obeyed the gospel. We've been buried in the water he gave of baptism to walk in newness of life. Then we're his children. He's our Father. So that's a true statement. But there are prayers that we see in biblical times, like Cornelius, where God's listening. It's just that Cornelius couldn't address him as the Father. But he believed he was out there. He wanted to know the truth, and the truth was provided to him. Number four, God knows what we need before we ask. And so we talked about that last week. Well, I shouldn't have to ask then. Why should I pray to God? He already knows what I need. Because he wants us to. He wants us to ask. He wants us to ask for the things that we need. He knows we need them, but he's not going to listen to us unless we ask for them. Number five, Bible characters praying during the prayed, I'm sorry, Bible characters prayed during the day and night, while working, before eating, etc. It wasn't a situation where they went once a month to a mountaintop to pray. It was a situation where they were praying day and night. They were praying while they were working. They were praying to ask blessings upon the things that had been provided for them, what they would partake of. So here we have all these examples in the scriptures of where prayer is appropriate. And it appears that prayer is appropriate just about any time. Number six, don't quote scripture to God, and don't ask for the kingdom to come. It already has come. Colossians 1:13. Well, we talked about that. The kingdom has come. There's no reason to say, Father, thy kingdom come. Okay? And as far as quoting scripture, you know, it depends how that's done. If you were to pray that says, Father, you know how you have said in the scripture, blah, blah, blah. Well, we desire that. Or we ask that you bless us in that way or something like that. That doing that is appropriate. What he's saying here is don't get up and start quoting. And this here again, this is Ken Butterworth's point that he's making. It's not God, it's not somebody, but it's just his personal thing. Don't get up and give scripture to God. Don't get up and quote scripture in your prayer and just, you know, verbatim, just scripture. Now, if you're making a point with it that says, Father, you know, you said this in your will, and you quote a little excerpt from a scripture or something, and you say, this is something that we need, we pray for it, that'd be appropriate. Don't get up and start quoting. In other words, don't get up and say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And on. Don't pray a prayer like that. That's not a heartfelt, genuine, from the heart prayer. That is a rehearsed reiteration of what the scriptures say. Now, if you want to talk about those points in your prayer, about forgiveness of our sins and help us to forgive others who sin against us, the principle is appropriate. But don't quote scripture as a prayer. You could go to Psalms and you could quote, if you say, for example, you were really remorse over something, you could quote Psalms 51. It's like David when he prayed the prayer to God after he had sinned with Bathsheba. You could quote that prayer and it would be a prayer of repentance. But that's not what you need to say. You say what you need to say. Prayer is personal. Prayer is what's coming from your heart and your mind. So don't quote scripture when you try to talk to God. He knows what the scripture says. He doesn't need you to tell him. Okay, number seven. It's a sin to call God Pop, Daddy, big man upstairs, dad, etc. His name is holy. You don't talk to people that are holy with those terms. You may talk to your earthly father like that, but your heavenly father is someone who is holy. And you don't approach him in words that are not appropriate for him, being who he is. So we need to stay away from that. There are people today who've gotten into this thing about praying. You know what? Just talk to him like he's our big buddy, you know. And that's not who God is. God is not your buddy. God is your holy father, and you need to treat him that way. All right, we'll pick back on number eight next week, finish that up, get into a question, the next lesson about hard questions.